Hello everyone, today we continue to learn more about the memory management of ECS. We will explore the concept of archetype and chunk and how they affect the memory layout and performance of our game. I will also tell you how that can be affected by some of your coding and design choices. Let's take a similar situation as the one we implemented in the previous episode of the series. To support the explanation, I will take the example of entities that can move and take damage. Let's first see what it would look like in MonoBehaviour land. We would need 5 types of data: the position, the speed, the direction, the health, and an amount of damage. Let's assign each one a different number of colored squares to represent each byte of data. The position will have 3 squares for x, y, and z, speed only 1, direction 3 again for x, y, and z, and 1 for the health and damage. How would a game object with this data look like in memory? If we represent the memory space with gray squares for available memory, creating the game object would assign the memory sequentially like so. It could happen that other game elements taking up memory, like time, would be assigned in between our game object instantiation. So the memory space of a second game object may not be consecutive to the first one. We could also have other types of objects, such as building in an RTS game, that usually don't move. So, they would only have part of the data. How does that affect the performance of our game? Well, the CPU doesn't work directly out of the RAM. It works with a local cache memory. That cache is organized in cache lines. For the purpose of the demonstration, I won't use the typical 60-byte cache line size. But you will get the idea. When the CPU reaches an instruction that needs some data it doesn't have in cache, it will fetch it from the RAM. Instead of fetching only that data, it will fetch a full cache line worth of data. Then it can process the instruction and continue the algorithm. If it misses some data again, it will fetch again the data from the RAM. That fetching operation is often referred as a cache miss. This cache miss takes time and stalls the processing for several CPU cycles. So avoiding them will benefit the performance of our game. Then, how does ECS help in avoiding those cache misses? Enter the archetype and chunks. I've already mentioned it in previous videos, but archetypes are a set of components that matches an entity. So, in our case, we have 2 archetypes. One for the unit, and one for the building. Thanks to that, we can lay out our memory in a much more efficient way. Instead of blindly assigning the next available memory, we can pre-allocate some memory to match our archetype. These memory allocations are our chunks. Since 1.0, a chunk can hold up to 128 entities, but they are limited to 16 kilobytes. So if an entity is big enough, the capacity can be lower. Again, for the demonstration, I won't use those values since it would make things too little for the screen. Given our archetype, if we take a chunk size of 45 bytes, we could make a chunk of 5 units and one of 9 buildings. Now, when we instantiate an entity, instead of putting the data in memory sequentially by entity, we will do it by data type. Since we know in advance the size of our data and how much entity can be stored in a chunk, we can offset the memory allocation of each data type to make the data type allocation sequential. This, coupled with the fact that system updates is done by behavior for all entities, unlike in-game object, make it much more efficient for the CPU to fetch the data from the RAM. Thanks to ECS, we get all these benefits for free. But there are still things you need to be aware of regarding your design and code choices that can affect the memory layout. What are those? The answer right after a quick break from me to thank you for your patience and support. It really means a lot to me seeing that you like my videos. And I'm sure others would like it too. So like and share as usual. Thank you. Before we see how your choices can impact the chunk and memory layout, I'll explain the archetype window of Unity. It will be an important tool for you to see the impact of your choices. The archetype window can be opened through the Window Entities menu. It will contain all the possible archetypes of your game. Its filtering capabilities are not very good, but hopefully Unity will improve them in time. If I go and find one of our archetypes, you will see on the right-hand side the list of components for that archetype, the number of entities that match that archetype, the maximum number of entities that can fit in a chunk for that archetype, and the current number of chunks and the remaining entity space available in those chunks. With each data type, you see how much memory is allocated per entity. As you can see here, the local two-word component takes 64 bytes per entity. The simulate component takes 0 bytes. It's a tag component as indicated by the little tag icon in front of the puzzle piece. But what about buffers? How are they assigned in memory? Each entity can have a different number of elements, so we can't possibly allocate memory for that. Yet, as you can see, the archetype will reserve 144 bytes for each entity's tower buffer. That is the default memory capacity reserved for each buffer, 128 bytes of data and 16 bytes of header. You can control how much memory is reserved for the data by default using the internal buffer capacity attribute. For this example, if I set the internal capacity to 0, then the reserved memory drops down to just the 16 bytes of the header. It also impacts the maximum number of entities you can fit in a chunk, making it more efficient to iterate over the other data. But if there is not enough memory reserved for the data, where does it go? Well, if the number of elements exceeds the internal capacity, then the buffer is reallocated outside of the chunk. But the reserved memory is not fluid. So if you had set an internal capacity of 4 elements, you will waste 4 elements worth of memory on the chunk. If that happens to enough entity of your chunk, you might hurt your performance by paying the cost of indirection to get the buffer data and the cost of a smaller chunk capacity. A similar indirection happens for blob assets, the difference being that the blob asset reference has a fixed size and that there will only be one blob asset for all the entities sharing the same data. Now, if we look below our component list, you will see we have external components, namely shared components. We haven't seen those yet, but I will introduce their concept and purpose here. A shared component, like the name suggests, is used to hold data that is shared by multiple entities. In that sense, it serves a similar purpose to the blob assets. But the major difference is that entities that have the same shared component data value will be forced in the same chunk. Conversely, if they don't have the same shared value, they will end up in different chunks. So, in our example, if we were to make the same entity into another subscene, it would have two chunks of memory reserved, one for each subscene. This also means I will have twice the memory footprint. Then why would I want that? It can be helpful to perform batched operation on entities. The hybrid renderer uses it for some of its data, and so does the physics package. I'll finish by introducing the notion of structural change that will be important to understand when dealing with jobs. A structural change happens when the archetype of an entity changes. Either it loses a component or gets a new one, or when an entity is destroyed or created. When that happens, the gap left by the living entity is filled by the last entity of the chunk. This will trigger a change in the number of entities present in a chunk. Some chunks may even be created or destroyed. This creates what is referred as a sink point. We will learn all about it and the other job-related notions such as dependencies and race conditions in the upcoming videos. In the meantime, don't forget to like and share the video if you find it useful. Leave your questions and remarks in the comment section below or on Discord. And if you want to support me at no additional cost to you, consider using my affiliate link in the description when you want something from the asset store. See you in the next video.